I want to share with you this morning that God keeps His promises. God keeps His promises. I know that life can be tough. I know that things can be rough. I know when we go through different aspects of our life, sometimes it's almost unbearable. Sometimes the hurt and the pain that people suffer and go through is one of the most difficult things that some people can handle. Now, I do not condone suicide, and I don't tell people to go do that. But I understand why sometimes people do that. They get so to the point of despair and so hopelessness in their life. They have nothing to live for. And so they think, or I should say they are persuaded, that the only way out is to end their life, and that will end all the misery and all the pain. And that's not true. See, God keeps His promises. Now, if I asked you this morning, how many of you have ever had someone promise you something and fail in that promise, raise your hand. Almost all of us have had that happen in our life. Someone made a promise and didn't keep that promise. And after a while, when that same person keeps making promises and keeps relenting on those promises, what begins to happen? You begin to lose trust in what that person says. But I want you to understand this morning that God keeps His promises. God is not a man that He should lie. God will always keep His promise. Now, the thing that we have to make sure is that God is doing the promising. A lot of times we get caught up in our emotions and we get caught up in things and we think God says something, or the enemy comes and masquerades his voice like God's and says to do something or go somewhere or participate in something. And then we do and we get caught in it, and we find out it's a trap, and we find out that it wasn't God. Then we get disappointed and we say, well, God, I thought you told me to do this and I thought it was you. And the problem isn't so much God as it is us understanding the promises of God. We in the beginning of our ministry, we had books. I don't know if we have any more, but we do have little books called God's Promises for You. And we gave those little booklets out many, many times. If you don't have one, I think we might have a few hanging around somewhere. But it's all the promises of God. And if you would read all of those promises, they're for you. They're not for the person sitting behind you or the person sitting behind you. They're for you. And so you say, yeah, but what about the person behind me? Yeah, I'm talking to them too. It's for you. So everybody can understand and know that God keeps His promise. That when we pray and we ask anything in His will, that God keeps His promise. Now, let's look at this portion of Scripture this morning, Hebrews chapter 6, starting with verse 13. It says, for when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater. I hear people all the time say this. I swear on my mother's soul. You know, they're trying to make a point that they're telling the truth. I swear on my mother's soul. I swear on my grandmother's soul. But grandma, there is someone greater than grandma. See, when he says, for when God made a promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater. In other words, there was no one more powerful, more willing, more able to keep that what he was about to speak. There's no one greater that can keep that promise. Not even you or I. But God, that he could swear by no one greater, he swore by himself. In other words, he made a promise. If I could read it that way, because he could promise by no greater, he promised by himself. By the integrity and the character of who God is. The Bible says he's not a man that he should lie. So we understand the character and the nature and the attribute of God, that God does not lie. Put that in your spirit. Put that in your heart. God does not lie. Isn't that wonderful? How many believe that God doesn't lie? Let me see your hand. Do you know that God says in His Word that you are fearfully and wonderfully made? Remember, you just said God doesn't lie. So when you look in that mirror when all these thoughts that nobody loves you and nobody cares about you, You just remember that scripture that God said, you are fearfully and wonderfully made. That's a promise of God. That's a statement of God. That's the truth of God. Because there's no one like you. And so when he says, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself. Are you hearing me this morning? When God makes a promise, when God gives a promise, he's not like you and I, or grandma, or grandpa. He makes a promise. He says that when he made this promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, there was no one greater than God. God could not say, I swear on my mother's soul. He couldn't say that. You and I say that. Or I swear on my grandma's soul. But God could not say that. So he says, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself, or he promised by himself. Now I want you to notice the promise that God said. We're talking about this morning, how God keeps his promise. Can I get an amen somewhere? God keeps his promise. God keeps his promise. Verse 14. And in that promise, God said these words. Understand, when God speaks a word, he speaks a creative word. Are you hearing me? God doesn't just speak words just to speak words. He doesn't just give his opinion. God says something, it's because he means it. And when God says something, it's because he is about to bring something out of nothing. There is a creative power of God that when he speaks a promise or he begins to speak something to an individual, that is going to come to pass. It may take a while. It may take a short duration of time. It may take a long duration of time. But when God speaks something, it will happen. It will come to pass. And he told us to Abraham, he said, surely. He said, I'm telling you, watch what I'm telling you, God said. Abraham, pay attention, Abraham. What I'm telling you now, I'm telling you blessing. He said, surely blessing, I will bless you. And multiplying, I will multiply thee. Praise God. Everyone say, thank you, Jesus. He's going to bless me. And he's going to multiply me. Come on, say it. Didn't the Bible say the promises of Abraham are for you and I? Amen. Then if they're for you and I, surely God's going to bless me. Surely God's going to multiply me. Hallelujah. But here's the problem. Before this promise came into effect, there were some things in Abraham that God had to do in Abraham to get this in his life. The first thing God had to do was put a call on Abraham's life. You might remember the story in Genesis. God appears to Abram, and he says, that's when his name was Abram before he changed it to Abraham. He says, Abram, here I am, Lord. Understand that Abram was a worshiper of idols. Hello. God broke through that sin of idolatry, that false gods that he worshiped. And many times, he needs to break through the false gods that we serve. You say, but I'm a Christian. I don't serve false gods. Let me tell you, you want to know one of the biggest false gods you serve is your opinions. You serve them, you bow to them, and you obey them. I didn't say your convictions. I said your opinions. And God had to do something in Abraham. And he told Abraham, he says, Abraham, So I want you to get thee out of thy country, from thy kindred, from thy father's house, to a land that I'm going to show you. In other words, Abraham, you're too familiar with your family. You depend too much on your family. You depend too much on your economy and your circumstance and your surroundings. So Abraham, in order for this promise, are you hearing me this morning? In order for this promise that I'm going to surely bless you and I'm going to multiply you, you must take yourself out of that environment to a place that's going to begin to roll the ball of blessing and multiplying. You've got to go to the place that God has for you that's going to start the ball rolling for blessing and multiplication. So what God had to start to reveal in Abraham was, he had to start to reveal that in Abraham's heart, he wanted to see how obedient Abraham was going to be. Because see, your blessings and your multiplying is based upon your obedience. You're not going to just sit back and be disobedient to the things of God and expect God to bless you and multiply you. It's not going to happen. And when it doesn't happen, people get discontented, they get angry, they get mean, they get upset with God and say, God, why are you delaying? And God says, I'm not delaying, you're not obeying. God wants to take you out of the place you are to the place you need to be so that the blessings can start to flow and the multiplication can begin to take process. The second thing God needed to do, one was revealed to him that he needed to be obedient. The second thing he needed to do was stop depending on people. Get thee out of thy father's house, from thy kindred, that which is familiar. Get thee out from that place to a land that I will show thee. But God, see, this is what we would do today if God said that. But God, I don't have a job. I don't have a place to live. God, where you're sending me, there's no cell phones. There's no internet. There's no cable. God, how am I going to find a job? How am I going to find housing? There's no real estate brokers. We give God all of those things. But don't we even stop for a moment to know that God knows about all those things? That in his foreknowledge and his wisdom, he already knows that there's no cell phones. He knows there's no cable. See, God is just looking for us to be obedient. And the moment you're obedient, things begin to flow. Praise God. Hallelujah. The moment you decide that you're going to do things honestly with integrity and character, and you're not going to lie, you're not going to cheat, you're not going to do things under the table, you're not going to do things behind the back, try to get away with things and money, guess what? God will begin to multiply you. The moment you begin to tithe and give your money to God, you'll have so much money, you'll be saying, my God, what happened? God will bless you. He multiplies back to you. When you do it God's way, you can do it your way. Oh, you'll get a little twinkle here and there. But things could go a lot smoother, a lot better when you obey God. Amen. So surely, I will bless you. In other words, that's God's promise. Say, God, you promise you're going to bless me. Say that. What is it that you want from God? Let me ask you that question this morning. What is it that you want from God? Tell him whatever you want from God. Tell him. Now, don't tell God I want a Rolls Royce or something stupid. Because, see, God will meet your need, but he won't meet your greed. Amen. Although if he wanted me to have a Rolls Royce, he'd give me one. And then I would take it and sell it, and I'd, for $300,000, I could buy everybody in here a car. Because see, I don't need a Rolls Royce. Somebody shout amen. Amen. But what is it that you want from God? What is it that you need from God? Tell him this morning, God, if I pray according to your will, I know that you hear me. And according to your word, you said, if you hear me, then I shall have those things that I ask. Hallelujah. See, faith goes out on a limb. Faith doesn't stay in a nice little tree shaded area. Faith takes a step out. Hallelujah. Is it God's will that none should perish, but all should come to everlasting life? Well, I believe that there will be some that perish because of their stubbornness. They refuse to bend their heart to Jesus. But I believe that God will work on that person and 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 continue to work on that person because he made you a promise. As for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. So if you're praying about a loved one that you want to see saved, stand up for me right now. You're praying for a loved one to be saved. I want you to pray this prayer. Father, come on. I thank you for saving. Now say their name. I thank you because it is your will that none should perish. Come on, say it. Mean it with all your heart. So this morning I take a new stand. Instead of complaining and moaning and groaning about this person not being saved, I'm going to begin to thank you and praise you for their salvation. I don't know when it's coming, Lord, but I know it's coming. And I know they're watching my life, so I better live right. Come on. So, Father, thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah. I want to thank God this morning for Kurt's salvation. I want to thank God that Kurt is going to be sitting with you right beside you. That Kurt's going to love God and he's going to love you more than he ever loved you before and love your family more than he ever loved your family before. He's going to love your children. He's going to love this church. He's going to love Jesus. Hallelujah. Debbie, I want to thank God that Mark is going to be saved. And he's going to restore his life. And he's going to bring blessing instead of curses that have happened in his life. Because even though it looks like the road is coming to a dead end in his life, always remember wherever there's a dead end with God, there's always an exit ramp just before the end. God will bring him in. So we thank God for bringing in Mark. We thank God for restoring Donna Holman. Thank God for restoring Bob's sister. Thank God for restoring Kathleen. Thank God for restoring Tara. Pray with faith, believing. Don't pray, well, I hope so, God. Now, what happens as humans, as we are, what happens a lot of times is when we don't see the immediate result, we start to waver, we start to faint a little bit. But I want you to understand one thing, that when God made this promise to Abraham, that in his seed, all the nations of the earth would be blessed. From the time of the promise to the time of the fulfillment was 24 years. Are you hearing me? From the time God made the promise until the fulfillment of that promise when his son Isaac was born was about 24 years. And oh, by the way, just so you'll know that when God made this promise to Abraham, he was 74 years old. God told Abraham, you're going to have a seed. He probably said, I'm 74 years old. But by the time his son was born, he was 99 years old. Come on. He was 99 years old. So in that duration of time, in that process of time, God was working on Abraham. God was working on Sarah. Then after that 24 years or so, when God fulfilled that promise, about 12 or 13 years after that promise was fulfilled, you can see Abraham getting blessed. He increased in goods, he increased in wealth, he increased, and the blessings were starting to multiply in his life, and he was growing, his family was growing, his stock was growing, his finances was growing. And then he looked at his son Isaac, who was roughly around 12, 13 years old. And God spoke to Abraham. Abraham. Yes, Lord. Sacrifice your son. Your only son. Why did God do that? Why did God, not a rhetorical question, why did God say, sacrifice the son I gave you? And this is a lesson for parents. Because obedience to God is more important than you putting your children before God. See, in order to receive the continuation of blessing. Yes, blessings start. Yes, the ball is rolling. Yes, you're obedient. You've listened. You did what he said to do. Now the ball of blessing and multiplication is happening in your life. But in the continuation of that, don't let those things be the thing that you serve. That will stop the flow. That will block the flow of the multiplication and the blessings in your life. When you begin to turn from God being your source to whatever it is in your life, when you begin to be more obedient to the things that God has blessed you in rather than the God who blessed you, that will block the flow of blessing in your life. Is this helping anybody? Verse 15. The Bible says, and so, after he had what? He had what? Some of you are not even reading it. You don't even want to read the word. Never mind, be patient. You don't even want to say the word. So after he had patiently. We don't want to be patient. We want it now. But he says, after he had waited patiently, after he had patiently what? Endured. Sometimes God's promises has to make you endure. See, he endured 24 years. Abraham didn't know it was going to take 24 years. God didn't tell him it's going to take 24 years. God doesn't tell us that. He's not going to tell you it's going to take 24 years, so then you know, and then you stop marking the calendar every day, and then you're happy. One day closer. No. One day turns to 2 days. 2 days turns to 2 weeks. 2 weeks turns to 2 months. 2 months turns to 2 years. 2 years turns to 20. See, I can use this illustration because it fits in what I'm speaking about. When Linda and I used to go down Hathaway Road and we go by the Days Inn, and we knew that Debbie Marshall used to go there and dance there and party there when she was backslidden. I can remember my wife grabbed my hand, saying, "Debbie's in there. And pray for her." And we prayed. We didn't know when she was going to come back. But we prayed, right, honey? We'd pray for her and we'd say, "God, bring her out of that hellhole. Touch her heart. Begin to speak to her. Bring her home, God." It was many years after. Come on, somebody. When one day I looked up, and there she was. Tears in her eyes. It was a long wait. But we received the promise. We received the promise, and it wasn't in our timing. We had to patiently endure. But it happened. And it's going to happen for your loved one if you patiently endure. Keep going. Don't give up, Priscilla. John and Lucy will come. But he patiently endured. The Bible says after he had patiently endured. Say after. He didn't get the promise. He didn't get the fulfillment of the promise before he reached that place of obtaining. Oh, I don't know if you're getting it. Through that endurance, after that endurance, he obtained it. You are not going to get anything from God until you endure with God. You and I are not going to get anything from God until we are enduring with him. And once we endure patiently with him, we're going to receive it. Say, "I'm going to receive it." Let's look at verse 16. "For men verily swear by the greater." I swear to God on my mother's soul. They make these. "And an oath of confirmation is to them an end of all strife." They think that's going to be the end of it. You know, you're going to believe them. I swear to God it's true. But is it? Verse 17. "Wherein God," now, like I said before, man will promise you something and falls apart. But we're talking about "wherein God" now. Say the word with me, "willing." Is God willing? Come on. Willing, God, wearing God, willing a little bit, just enough. God, more abundantly. Come on, more abundantly. To what? To show unto the heirs of promise. Who's that? That's you. You're an heir. Joint heir with Christ. Oh, Rabba Shatalaba. You're a joint heir with Christ. You have an inheritance. Oh, come on. Oh, if you can tap into this, I'm telling you, you'll be blessed. You'll be blessed. Excuse me. God willing more abundantly. Huh? Huh, Gail? More abundantly. To show unto the heirs of what? Oh, you have an inherited promise. Oh, hallelujah. You haven't inherited here heir of promise. You're an heir. You have a promise. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. You have a promise. Hallelujah. And God is trying during the process of enduring, patiently waiting for that promise. God is doing something in you and I. He's changing our thinking. He's changing our hearts. He's changing our lives. He's putting us in a new position. Why? To get ready for the continuation of the flow of the multiplication of blessings and promises. Heirs of the promise, the immutability of his counsel. In other words, God's sitting you down right now, tonight, this morning, and he's speaking to you through this message, and he's telling you, what I'm telling you is the truth. You are an heir according to the promises. And that if you will obey me and you will sacrifice for me, the continuation of the multiplication of blessings will be on your life. Now, don't we sometimes think we know more than God? Sometimes we do. And we say, well, God, I want to do this first. I got to do this first. God says, no. I want you to do this. To obey is better than sacrifice. The promise of immutability of his counsel is confirmed. How many of us are always praying for confirmation? God, if it's your will, let the toaster turn black. God, if it's your will, let CBN be turned on the television automatically. God, if you want so-and-so to stay home, let the glass fall on his toe. Always looking for confirmation. We do that, don't we? God, I know it's June and I know it's 85 degrees outside, but if it's your will, let it be snowing tomorrow. Then I'll know that I know that I know that it's you. No. God made a promise according to his immutability of his counsel, of his wisdom, of his justice, of his strength, and of his majesty, of who he is. And he confirmed it. Oh, come on. God didn't only promise, but he confirms it to you. How? By an oath. Come on. God's making an oath to you. He's swearing by no one greater than himself an oath to you. And I want you to get it in your spirit. I want you to get it in your head, wherever it has to go first. Let it begin to seep into your heart. God, by the immutability of his counsel, confirmed it by an oath. Verse 18. Here's the oath, number one. Oh, Rabba Shatalaba, I feel the Holy Ghost. That by two immutable things, one in which it was impossible, say impossible, for God to lie. God is not a liar. He's confirming his oath and the immutability of his counsel to you by these two infallible, immutable things. One it which is impossible for God to lie, that we might what? Have a strong consolation. Wow. To who? I'm sorry, consolation. Who have what? Fled for refuge. To lay hold upon the hope set before us. That hope is Jesus. See, because it's in Jesus that we're heirs, co-heirs with Christ. You can't be an heir apart from Christ. You can't be an heir because you come from the family you come from, or because you got money, or you got socially a position socially in life. You can't get it that way. The only way you get it is being a joint heir with Christ. And the only way that Christ could give it was to die to self. Come on. The only way that Christ fulfilled that promise was that he gave up his life. And God says for you to give up your life, your way, the way you want to do things, what you want to do, and go God's way. That's the beginning of the flow of the multiplication of the blessing. Come on. Come on, and the fulfillment of the promise. Some of us, we only get to the ground level, if you will, of the promise. We get it. We get it in our spirit. We go, yes, Lord. Amen. Praise God. And then we wait, but we're not being obedient. And we're waiting and waiting, and God says, don't wait on me. I'm waiting on you. I'm ready to pour out a blessing upon you so great that you will not be able to contain. Doesn't that what the word says? That God is able to pour out a blessing so great that you cannot even contain it? He said, if you give of my tithe and offering, he says, not only will I rebuke the devourer for your sake, that which devours your money, that's what takes your money, what's that thing that you never have enough, I'm going to take that devourer out. Well, come on. And then he says, and I'm going to pour out, I'm going to open up the windows. Come on. I'm going to open up the windows of heaven. I'm going to open them up, and I'm going to pour, I'm going to pour, I'm going to pour, I'm going to pour, I'm going to pour out a blessing. You won't even be able to contain it. And if you run out of places to store it, give it to me. Give me of the overflow. For we have fled for a refuge to lay hold upon the hope set before us. God keeps his promise. And for part of verse 19. Which hope we have as an anchor. Hallelujah. Of our soul. The hope that we have. And the two things, number one, God is immutable. And two, God doesn't lie. And based on that hope, that's an anchor for the promise. Oh, come on. That's an anchor for the promise that is going to come. The promise is going to come. Say that with me. The promise is going to come. It's going to come. Because that hope is an anchor to our soul. It's sure and steadfast. And it will keep us. Come on. That anchor is Christ. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I will not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. Jesus is that anchor. Now, Jesus is the anchor. He gave up his life. We give up our life. He's an heir of the promises of God. We're joint heirs with Christ, the Bible says. Are we getting this? Are we receiving this this morning? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just want to encourage Sunamita. She just came in. I was to greet you. Good morning. I love her. Get ready. Sunamita, get ready for the multiplying of God's blessing in your life. I've been talking about that in Genesis. I've been talking about how Abraham had to believe God for the promise. But it took 24 years. The Bible says he endured patiently for the promise. But there were things in him that God wanted to get out of him. God wanted to get him out of familiarity with his family. Get thee out of thy country, from thy father's house, to a land that I will show thee. God had to remove him from that which was familiar. See, and unless Abraham obeyed, it would not begin the ball rolling for the blessings and the multiplication. Abraham had to make the decision to be obedient to God. And when he did, that started the ball rolling. Come on. Now you have to get the CD if you want to know the rest of it. Look at 2 Peter 3:9 for a moment. The Lord is not what? Slack. Concerning his what? As men some count. Well, God, where are you? How come you're taking so long, God? Blah, 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 blah. God's not slack. God's not a slacker. Even when we're quacking, God ain't slacking. Say that with me. The Lord is not slack. What's going to get the ball rolling to the multiplication and blessings in your life? What is it? Obedience. You got it. See, God's not a slacker. We got to patiently endure for the promise. Abraham, 24 years before the... You got the promise, 24 years, then the fulfillment. Once the fulfillment came, and he started to get in the ball, he started rolling, and he started multiplying, his seed began to multiply, he began to multiply financially and economically, and he started to grow. You know, he grew so much that him and Lot had to separate. He had so much stuff. But in the process of that, you know, the promise grew up, his son. Then all of a sudden, he started depending on his son again. And Isaac, oh, Isaac, you're the promise. Oh, Isaac, everything's going to come through you. And guess what? God told Isaac, now take Isaac and sacrifice him on the altar. And kill your son, your only son. God had to make sure that he had total obedience and alliance to himself. If you want the greater blessings in God, if you want the greater multiplication in God, it's going to take you to putting yourself on the altar. Come on. God's not going to ask you to put your child on the altar. He's going to ask you to put yourself on the altar. Crucify your own will. Crucify your own goals. Crucify your own decisions. And if you do that, you can allow the continuation of the multiplication. See, Abraham was blessed already. Abraham multiplied already. But that was a pivotal point in his life. Unless he was willing to sacrifice his only son, the continuation of that blessing would not occur until he became obedient. And the moment he did, oh my God, what happened? He went to Mount Horeb. He says he built an altar. Come on. Hallelujah. He had more of a God awareness. Come on. He had more of a God awareness in his life. I got to build me an altar. I got to commune with God. I got to get a blood covering for my sin. Come on. There was more intense relationship between him and God. wouldn't have came unless he took that obedient step. The blessing and the multiplication wouldn't have continued until he took that step. He said, yes, Lord, I'm going to do it. And he went there, and then he grew so greatly that he said, my herdsmen and Lot's herdsmen are fighting here. We got no room. So he said to Lot, listen to me. When you begin to have that encounter with God and closeness to God, you're not so much concerned about yourself. When you begin to see the multiplication and the blessings coming in your life, you're not so concerned about yourself anymore. And so when Abraham's people were fighting with Lot's people, they came together and Lot and Abraham said, look, tell you what, have first choice. Of all the land that you see, take your choice of the land. You choose. I'll take what's left. Are you getting this? You can't let go of the promise. Don't let go of the promise. See, if you always keep the promise that you're co-heir with Christ, amen. Joint heir with Christ, keep the promise. Even if you let the best go. Come on. Even if you let the best go. God has something better. Amen. You say, how do you know that? Because when Abraham let Lot choose, Lot looked it over and said, wow, look at that. All that land is all beautiful. Look, it's got springs and everything over there. He said, I'm taking that. So that Abraham turned and he went up into the mountain. Come on. When you have an experience with God, you don't want to go where God's not at. See, because the Bible says that when... See, and the thing is that Lot was just as blessed as Abraham. But what Lot did not have that Abraham had was he had a keen discernment and insight to God. And the Bible says when Lot chose all that land, this is the sad part, it says he pitched his tent towards Sodom. See, when you want to have the continuation of the blessing of God, you cannot pitch your tent towards Sodom. Hello? What happened with Lot? He lost the blessing. He lost the multiplication. In fact, him and his wife and others were told, get out, get out of there fast. We're destroying Sodom and Gomorrah. And then God told him, he says, look, I'm telling you right now, when you leave that town, don't even look back. What happened to his wife? See, disobedience. Come on, get this lesson. Disobedience. She disobeyed God. She thought in her mind, there's nothing wrong with me looking back. No, there's nothing wrong with you looking back as long as God said, didn't say, don't look back. But God said, don't look back. You hear what I'm saying? Nothing wrong with looking back. But if God says, don't look back, don't look back. And that's why in your life, don't look back. Paul said it this way, forgetting those things which are behind and press on toward the mark. You can't change what happened in the past. You can't change what went on before, but you can change your future. Amen. Don't look back to Sodom. What happened? Lot fled out of there. He had nothing. Lost the blessings. Oh, but it looked good in the beginning. Wow, look at all the plains and the fields and the water. Well watered, all my sheep. I'm going to grow bigger. I'm going to get bigger. Wow, so much greenery. I'll be able to multiply my sheep and multiply my stock and everything. I'll be able to sell it and get more money. I'm going to be rich. Oh, praise God. Hallelujah. Abraham took what was left, but it was well enough watered. Well enough to feed his flock, even to multiply him even greater. Come on, I hope you're getting this lesson this morning. I hope you're getting the lesson. That God wants to multiply and bless you. Come on. God doesn't always want you going from from hand to mouth every single day? I don't believe poverty is God's will. Because poverty means that your needs are not being met. And God's word says, I will meet your need according to my riches in glory. Come on. I'm not going to go as far as saying it's a curse, because I don't believe that. I believe circumstances and chance, as Ecclesiastes says, happens to every man. But God's going to bless you. He's going to bless us if we do things right. If we have integrity and honesty and character and we do it right, we won't cheat, won't steal, won't lie, won't cover up, won't do underhanded things. When we do that, God will bless us. And then the multiplication starts. Then you start getting blessed. And what does God's word say? It says, remember me. And don't forget me when all the blessings increase. Don't forget me. One of the things that people do, and we have a tendency to do this, is that when God begins to bless us, we forget him. Come on. God says, I can take it away just as much as I've blessed. You say, but that's an Indian giver. No. The blessings are according to your obedience. That's the whole crux of the teaching this morning. Let me read it one more time. Chapter 6, verse 13. I'm going to close with this. Hebrews 13, there you go. 6:13 rather. For when God made promise to Abraham, because he could swear by no one greater, there was no one greater than himself. So he swore by himself. In other words, he made a promise upon himself, his name, his integrity, his character, his immutability, his counsel, his power, his reputation. Verse 14. Saying, surely, everyone say surely. Blessing, I will bless thee. Have you got it this morning? God wants to bless you. We used to sing that song at Pastor Monroe's church. God's got a blessing for you. God's got a blessing for you. You surely can have it. Just reach right out and grab it. God's got a blessing for you. But if you moan and groan and complain, guess what? You're missing the blessing. Number one, he says, surely blessing, I will bless you, and multiplying, I will multiply you. Do you believe that? You believe that, Sunamita? Surely God is going to bless you. Surely he's going to multiply you. He's going to. He could swear by no one greater than himself. That's the surety of the promise. Verse 15, God keeps his promise. And so after he had patiently endured, it's going to take a while. Why? Why does it take a while? Why can't God just do it? Why? Because in order to receive it, you've got to be obedient. You've got to take the first steps of obedience. Get thee out of thy country, from thy father's house, to the land that I will show thee. Yeah, but God, I don't have a GPS. I don't know where I'm going. I don't know where I'm going. I don't have a place to go. I don't have a job. Go. That begins the process of multiplication and blessing, obedience. So after he had patiently endured, he what? Obtained. Everyone say obtained. You say, Pastor, why are you repeating yourself? Because revision is the key to retention. He obtained the promise. How many want to obtain the promise? Then let's be obedient to what the Lord has for us. Let's put aside all the other stuff and say, you know what? I'm my worst own enemy. I'm blocking the multiplication and the blessings in my life by being disobedient. And I'm not going to do that anymore.